Hello, everyone, and welcome to Studio One today. I'm Scott Seiler, along with Kim Fisher, Jennifer Vandergun, and Craig Troman. Nice of you to join us again today for Studio One. We have a fascinating show coming up. We're going to be talking about music, food. We'll have a demonstration called the Flashbake Oven, and also tourism in North Dakota and what this season holds for the state of North Dakota. We'll get to all that in just a moment. But Jennifer, what story is grabbing news headlines today?
President Clinton and Whitewater are in the news again.
And Craig, it's supposedly spring, but it sure doesn't feel like it.
Well, it sure doesn't. Today is going to be nice with temperatures in the 40s, but by the end of the weekend, back in the 20s, even some teens and snow.
Okay, more on that later.
Yes.
Thanks, Craig. Straight ahead on Studio One today, North Dakota's tourism director, Kevin Cramer, will explain the state's million-dollar television campaign to lure tourists to the state. Those ads start next week, and we'll give you an advance showing.
And later in our second half hour, a faster and more efficient way to cook in your home. It's called the Flashbake Oven, and we'll have a demonstration on just how fast it works.
And we'll have more on the weather and sports in just a few minutes. But now, Jennifer Vandergun with the top news stories at this hour. Jennifer?
Thanks, Scott. President Clinton says he didn't do anything wrong in the Whitewater real estate deal. The president took to the TV airwaves Thursday night to field questions from the media about the Whitewater controversy. He promised to cooperate with special counsel Robert Fisk, and he pledged not to be derailed from his domestic agenda. The evening's only new revelation was that the Clintons overestimated their Whitewater losses by $20,000. Mr. Clinton promised to release his tax returns from the late 1970s to shed more light on the affair. Clinton says he's like a lot of people. He and Mrs. Clinton invested money and they lost. The Labor Department is reportedly considering a ban on smoking in all workplaces. Labor Secretary Robert Reich is expected to announce the proposal, but a final decision is not expected until later this year. Administration sources say they're also considering other options for dealing with indoor pollution in the workplace. The Surgeon General held a national teleconference Thursday to warn teenagers about the dangers of smoking. Chlorine is a chemical common to our everyday lives. It's used in paper products, plastics, and most notably in swimming pools. The Clinton administration is talking about banning chlorine because of health and environmental concerns, and several lawmakers are expected to introduce legislation to ban or phase out chlorine. If such legislation goes through, the cost of new methods of disinfection in swimming pools and jacuzzis could be high. At UND's Hislop Sports Center, the change would be a small one. They already use an alternative system to disinfect the water.
We have to maintain a certain level of chlorine because the state health code requires us to have a certain level, but the most of the disinfect is done through electrolysis, so the chlorine is really not a factor.
Swimmers say they like the electrolysis system better than chlorine. Electrolysis is also more cost effective. A nationwide study has found 10% of Americans rely on food handouts, and children account for nearly half of the people needing help. The study was sponsored by Second Harvest, the country's largest network of food banks. Many people using food pantries also receive food stamps. Most say their benefits run out before the end of the month. A Grand Forks food cupboard spokesperson says they fed over 6,000 people in 1993. Grand Forks is seeing a consistent increase in the number of people who need help. Homelessness and poverty are everywhere in the United States. The people who are most affected are often forgotten. Studio One reporter Julie Connoran found some special people who are giving the best kind of donation to the needy, their own spare time.
Vista Volunteers is a national project that puts volunteers into communities to help solve problems. Most of the volunteers are college students. The volunteers sign up for a particular region, then the individual agency in that region interviews the applicants. After being chosen, the volunteer is set up in a community for 1 year and is asked to help with the problems and concerns in the particular community. The Quad County Agency now employs 4 Vista volunteers.
Some of the Vista volunteers work with members of the community on various fundraising programs. Others, like the 2 Vista volunteers that work here at the City Mission, work one-on-one with the clients, helping them with job placement or even helping them find a place called home.
The volunteers often come from different parts of the country, so each person brings unique perspectives.
While I was in college, the best experiences that I had was doing volunteer work, so the opportunity to do it full-time for 1 year seemed like a wonderful thing to do.
The volunteers are asked to live by humble means, so along with the good they are doing, they also build a little character.
I'm actually going to be learning much more than I'll be able to ever give back to the community. I mean, it's amazing to me, just even being here only 5 weeks or 6 weeks, how much I've already learned.
The Quad County Agency hopes to add volunteers with each passing year.
There are other agencies who want to have volunteers at their disposal also for new programs that are coming, so we're hoping to increase our program each year.
The Vista volunteers are dedicated to their cause, and new projects are being implemented all the time. With photographer Jake Henningsgaard, I'm Julie Connerin for Studio One News.
The Vista volunteers work a regular 8-to-5 workday, but are also on call. If a disaster occurs, like an earthquake or a flood, Vista volunteers from across the nation come together to help those affected. It really takes a special kind of person to give up that kind of time to help other people.
And live on practically nothing for it. Thanks, Jennifer. Well, the calendar says that it's spring, but the weather just doesn't seem to be cooperating. Craig joins us now with the weather. Craig?
Well, thanks, Kim, and things are relatively nice today, but as we get further ahead into the weekend, things are going to cool off and we may see some snow. Well, currently in Grand Forks, we do have a clear sky, a temperature of 27 degrees. The winds are out of the south, the southwest at 7 miles an hour, and our barometric pressure is falling. Well, taking a look at some temperatures around the region this morning, it's relatively cool where it's 23 in Winnipeg, 20 in the Twin Cities, 17 in Fargo, and 8 out in Bismarck. Well, on the national scene today, we're seeing a wide band of precipitation on the east coast. This is due to a low pressure system which is pushing its way into the Atlantic, followed up behind it by a high pressure, and they're mixing together and causing some problems along the east coast. The rest of the nation relatively clear, but a low pressure system is going to be building in the southwestern part of the United States, and that's going to cause heavy snow and precipitation in California and along the Rockies. Most of the Midwest should be relatively clear today, but out to the east, that heavy rain and snow is going to continue today. Well, as we look further ahead into the weekend, most of that rain should discontinue along the east coast. However, that low pressure system is going to continue to build across the Rockies and the Midwest, and we should be seeing some snow by late Saturday and Sunday. While temperatures today should be relatively mild, in fact, we'll see temperatures in the 40 degree range, some 30s to the south of us, 50s, 60s, and 70s across the south. Well, overnight tonight, things are going to be relatively mild. In fact, we'll see temperatures in the teens and 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s across the south. Well, for the rest of the day today, we'll expect to see a mostly sunny sky, a high temperature right around 40 degrees, and the winds are going to be out of the southwest at 10 to 15 miles an hour. Looking ahead into tonight, things will stay relatively mild, the temperature right around 20 degrees, because we're going to be seeing some clouds and the winds out of the south. But looking ahead into the weekend, here's where the bad news comes. 40 degrees on Saturday, but look ahead into Sunday and Monday, 26 degrees, and we're going to be seeing some snow. So Scott and Kim, winter may not be over.
Thanks, Craig. Well, it's not unusual for us to be seeing snow at the end of March.
That's the upper Midwest for us.
That's right. In sports, Magic Johnson is back in the news headlines.
Yes, he's back to basketball, but this time not as a player. Well, Magic seems to be raising a lot of controversy, jumping from one focus to another. First, it was AIDS awareness programs, and now, after a two-year resting period, back to the game he loves so much, coaching the LA Lakers. Well, in the NCAA Southeast Regional Tournament in Knoxville, Brent Hill hitting the glass for 22, while Duke eliminated Marquette 59-49. The Blue Devils advanced to the regional finals for the sixth time in seven seasons. In the NBA, the Knicks are on a roll as New York wins their 11th straight game, 123 over 106 over Minnesota. Hubert Davis playing in the place of injured John Starks. Into the NHL, we turn towards hockey. Pittsburgh extending their unbeaten streak with a 5 games with a 5-1 win over Ottawa. Sean McEachern netting 2 goals in that game. Those are the highlights. Local sports still ahead on Studio One, but now your first look at the rest of the overnight scores. UND's hockey season may be over, but there's still work to be done during the offseason. Studio One sports reporter Cody Schimmick takes a closer look at the person who's instrumental in keeping the Sioux on the ice year after year.
UND's hockey program has been up and down the past few years, But one thing has remained consistent: the precision cleaning of the ice by Dennis Gunderson, the Zamboni driver.
Avid Sioux fans have watched Gunderson clean the ice for years, but most know little about the man behind the machine.
He's been cleaning the ice at UND for 27 years.
27 years? You'd think he'd get tired of it, but never. He's the best man on the team. What would you do without him?
Keep him away from the wall. Set it there, will you? Just set it there.
Over the years, he's come close to sweeping up more than just ice.
I used to have chickens out there. I've had gophers out there. I've had some rats. And they're alive too, you know. Well, the rats are.
The rats were alive?
Yeah. The chicken was too.
When he's not on the ice, Gunderson is maintaining other sports buildings on campus. He maneuvers the Zamboni with precision at UND's games, but he admits he's had a few accidents.
During the state tournament, I lost one of the wheels. It was going ahead of me down the ice.
For fans who wonder where the Zamboni goes after cleaning, Gunderson drives it to a vault beneath the arena to dump the ice and store the machine. After so many years of hockey, Gunderson says he still has one favorite team.
Just the Sioux.
This is Cody Schimmick for Studio One Sports.
Before the university purchased a Zamboni, Gunderson maintained the ice by pulling an ice machine called a Schramber behind the tractor. Somehow, Kim, a Schramber driver just doesn't have the same ring as a Zamboni.
Just not quite as catchy, is it?
No, it doesn't. Well, we still have much more for you today on Studio One. First, we'll talk with Kevin Cramer and his plan to bring millions of tourists to the state of North Dakota.
But now, a look at some of the events happening around your area this week. Stay with us as Studio One continues.
Insurance. Unfortunately, it costs. Fortunately, it pays. Voller Insurance. Grand Forks, Devil's Lake, Bismarck.
I really recommend the Community National Bank because I think that they know how to take care of people, whether it's for business or personal. I want a relationship with a bank that understands my needs, and Community National fulfills that relationship. They're good. They're friendly, they're conscientious, they take the time to learn about your business, and they're willing to go that extra mile to help us when we need help.
Pick your insurance company? As your agent and broker, that's our exact job. We think we do it well, and have been since 1947. Voller Insurance, Grand Forks, Devil's Lake, Bismarck.
Starting next week, the North Dakota Department of Tourism will begin airing new television commercials in neighboring states and provinces to bring in more tourists. Surveys in the past 5 years show tremendous success in changing North Dakota's image from a cold and flat one to a very attractive spot for tourists. North Dakota's tourism director, Kevin Cramer, joins us today to discuss what these commercials will do for the state. Kevin, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you. My pleasure.
What exactly will they do for the state?
Well, what we hope they do is the TV commercials themselves, we hope that they'll strike an emotional chord with people, that they'll see these ads and think of a romantic image of North Dakota and the West and that kind of mythical old history that we're used to seeing in the movies. And say, hey, there's a place that I'd like to go. We'll complement, of course, the TV campaign with some print ads that will be a little more destination specific, provide a little more information, try to close the sale, if you will, after we get them into an emotional state where we want them.
Mm-hmm. Let's take a look at one of those ads.
Okay.
That's going to be
aired.
It's about the Western Cowboys, and it's a 60-second ad. Let's just take a quick look
sure.
at it.
If If ever there was a town built solely on dreams, she was it. For to her they came, with dreams of a new life in the New West. Mostly, they were cowboys. Dusty and gritty. Men sandpapered by wind and rain. Who some say still chase a mirage of golden cattle under an endless badland sun. And haunt the town of Medora. Who on a dreamy summer night comes alive still and sends her memories of the cowboys echoing from the stars.
The North Dakota ads. Exactly how much are you spending for television?
Well, the production of these ads, and we produced six new ads this year, the production of that probably costs $130,000 to $140,000. But we'll spend in the next biennium now, in the next 2 years, about $1 million running those ads in our proximity markets, just our surrounding states and, of course, Canadian provinces. And that'll get us through the biennium.
Mm-hmm. You know, that people say $1 million, you know, they say that's a lot of money. But you hope to recoup that somehow by bringing in the tourists.
Well, you know, our economic impact studies, and we obviously have to prove our worth every year, show that tourists spend a lot of money in North Dakota. Tourism is the third leading industry in the state. It is by far the fastest growing industry, although we're seeing some growth now in manufacturing, and we're pleased by that. But in 1992, for example, tourists spent about $826 million in North Dakota. That has an economic impact of well over $1 billion, obviously, and that actually translates into over $50 million into the state's general fund as well as some local tax coffers. So it has a real impact.
Mm-hmm. Wait, let's take a look at one more commercial. It's about the Theodore Roosevelt National Park. This one has no narration at all. Mm-hmm. It's music and it shows the sights of North Dakota. Tell us a little bit about what went into producing this ad.
Well, first of all, we produced three separate ads on the park. As you can see, this is aerial footage. It's shot from a helicopter. In fact, the shooter on this is the same person who did all the helicopter work for the most recent movie was a Cliffhanger. It's all shot on 35mm film. The park has never looked better than it did last year. One thing about all that rain, things were very green. And so we have some real, what we think is spectacular footage. There's originally scored music with it. And our philosophy on this, or our theory on this, is that, first of all, many people, in fact, most people probably in the Twin Cities, Duluth, Sioux Falls, don't even know that there is a national park in North Dakota. They think of a national park, they think of Glacier or Yellowstone. But here, North Dakota has a national park which has instant credibility because it is a national park. And also, you know, the interesting thing is it's the only national park in the country named after a person, and it happens to be named after the president who founded the National Park Service. So, you know, we just think that by showing this spectacular footage and, you know, tying it with the National Park Service, that we will increase our credibility with the traveling public.
Mm-hmm. And that's the hot spot. You hope that's the draw, the Badlands.
There's
the
no question. Theodore Roosevelt National Park is our largest draw. About 450,000 people went through it last year. And so it is our largest attraction, and it does have that kind of credibility. And the other thing is, Scott, most of our tourists either come from Canada or from the East. So to get to Theodore Roosevelt National Park, whether it's the North Unit or the South Unit, they have to travel really through the entire state. And so we maximize their time here.
Okay. If people are interested, what number should they call about
tourism? Well, that's the beauty, of course. The ads, even though they're kind of image-oriented, we always show our 800 number. It's 1-800-HELLO-ND. And so it's an easy one to remember. You don't have to go get a recipe card or anything at the beginning of the commercial. And then if they call us, and we get about 150,000 inquiries a year, we'll send them a packet complete with our vacation planning guide and any other information that they ask for. We have countless brochures on the various attractions, and so our travel counselors will help them have an enjoyable stay in North Dakota.
That's great. Thanks for joining us today, Kevin.
My pleasure.
Appreciate it. Well, still to come in Studio One, music from the Blenders as they release their second disc. The Fargo-based a cappella quartet is becoming more popular every day. But first, wireless communicating means more than just having a cellular phone. This new technology is creating exciting possibilities for the information superhighway.
Great food. can come from anywhere. As long as the shredded natural cheese comes from Sargento of Wisconsin.
So, what is the formula for a good investment? A good investment is long-term value, quality products, and strong support and service. You do have to look hard these days to find all these qualities in one product. So what do long-term value, quality products, and strong support and service equal? That's Honda of Grand Forks, where good value equals good business.
Newman Outdoor Advertising, a site for more eyes. Outdoor advertising, it's bigger than life. It gives you flexibility. Use it as a constant reminder. Use it to advertise your message or product. Outdoor advertising, it's big, it's bold. Get your message across. Outdoor advertising, it works. For more information, call Bill Kasager in Fargo or Grand Forks.
Remember how as children we loved to play with walkie-talkies? Well, as we've grown up, those toys have grown with us into other wireless technology advances for use at work and at home. Studio One's Craig Troutman reports on how cellular technology is an instrumental part of the information superhighway.
If you are one who travels frequently, you may appreciate some of the new technology being developed by MCI and its strategic alliance. The advancement of cellular communications may become so vast within the next few years that your car will literally guide your way. MCI has invested $1.3 billion in the Nextel Corporation. This combination is expected to accelerate the first nationwide offering of advanced wireless communication.
A $1.3 billion MCI investment in Nextel will accelerate the availability of advanced wireless voice and data communications, bringing these services to business, consumers, and government customers months or even years ahead of competing companies.
This technology allows digital clarity as well as advanced written and verbal communications. With a single telephone number, you will be able to track, answer, and even list your calls. A new electronic notepad may make using the post office obsolete. This pad allows you to send and receive messages. It even makes planning your itinerary as easy as pushing a single button. You may be asking yourself how and when this will happen. Well, MCI and the new alliance are certain it will happen soon.
MCI's choice of Nextel as the foundation of its wireless service means that a truly seamless national network delivering advanced all-digital integrated communications will quickly become a reality.
By the year 2004, MCI feels the competition will have driven prices down to the point that up to 90 million people could be using wireless communications.
The market for wireless voice and data represents a huge opportunity. Today, there are some 15 million subscribers to cellular voice service. This market is expected to grow to between 80 and 90 million users by the year 2004 and generate revenue between $40 and $50 billion.
To some, the initial investment may be more than they desire. However, for others, time is the essence, and every bit saved is significant. Even in some of the world's most desolate places, technology is not far behind. Here in Burrow, Alaska, citizens are dealing with a large problem, polar bears. Due to recent hunting regulations, the population of polar bears in this area has seen a dramatic increase, which in return is alarming the community. However, these individuals are wasting no time in protecting themselves. They have organized a group which some say will relieve the problem.
Right now, I'm doing the polar bear patrol. After they had this guy got killed in Pointley, I think that's when they start getting the polar bears away from the villages.
But how much can people do alone? Thanks to a donation by Cellulink, the bear patrol's job has just become easier. They are now equipped with cellular phones which keep them in constant communication. By alerting residents of possible danger, the Polar Bear Patrol is not only ensuring the safety of humans, but also the safety of bears. This is Craig Troutman for Studio One.
We'll be back with more on Studio One, including the a cappella sounds of the group The Blenders, an advanced look at their second compact disc.
Driving doesn't just kill drunk drivers. Next time your friend insists on driving drunk, do whatever it takes to stop him.
Hey, were you guys born in a house?
Yeah. What have we got to graze on?
Nothing.
Please?
Now don't be making those big cow eyes at okay.
It is okay if you give them the good stuff. Mootown Snackers cheese and sticks or cheese and pretzels. The deliciously dippable snacks.
Animals.
From Mootown Snackers.
Your approach is looking good, Cobra.
The men and women in the National Guard and Reserve face some tough challenges when they serve. Challenges that teach them discipline, leadership, and technical skills that make them better employees. So when they need time off to serve, don't make their toughest challenge approaching you.
The a cappella group, The Blenders, have learned a lot during their first couple of years of touring. The quartet's voices have grown and blended into an amazing, rich quality. They'll release their second CD in about a month, but Studio One was invited to a special party and a chance to listen to their latest CD, From the Mouth.
You'll always have that special touch. Oh, but someday that girl just won't be there.
One of the songs on The Blenders' second CD is The Girl Is Good. The new disc is called From the Mouth and comes with an a cappella advisory, meaning no instruments. The Blenders say this is a better representation of who they are. A couple of years ago, The Blenders released their first disc, Totally Whipped, and went touring around the country with people like Bobby V, opening for Jay Leno in Las Vegas, and even appearing on the Arsenio Hall show.
Do something.
Go!
Well, I guess it would be nice if I could touch your body. Oh, no, not everybody. There's nobody like you. Oh, well, I gotta think twice before I give my heart away.
The Blenders have also been named the National Association of Campus Activities 1994 Contemporary Artist of the Year. The Blenders' Darren Russ says it wasn't easy.
I've learned that this is hard work. It's really hard work. You know, you want to make it in the music business because it's a glamorous thing. You're just kidding yourself because it's not. It's real hard.
She wants to sing and play in a cover band.
They mixed and mastered the CD themselves in the recording studio they own. The Blenders work as a team and make decisions as a team. However, each one contributes in their own way to the disc. Tim Casper calls himself the finishing touch kind of guy.
We feel so fortunate because there are a lot of really artistic and creative people out there, and there's a lot of frustrated people and looking for outlets and things to display their creativity. And I feel for those people, and I'm frustrated too, but at least I'm thankful every day that we get the opportunity to really have an outlet.
Well, I need someone to hold me, but I'm gonna wait for something more. Because I gotta have faith.
The Blenders have come a long way since their first disc. They traveled all across the country. This past year, doing about 250 performances. This year, they hope to cut that number down. And as Ryan Lance points out, traveling does put a toll on a person.
And my job takes me places that I probably would never ever go to, like
small towns in Iowa or Indiana or, you know, just the backwoods of Georgia, you know, places like that. I mean, I would never ever have any reason to go to these places unless I had a vehicle like this singing group.
The Blenders put on this special release party in their hometown of Fargo-Moorhead. They say they've received so much support from people in the community, they want to give something back. So they had an advanced showing of their video, second disc, and an autograph session which had people lined up for hours. The Blenders' Paul Dunkirk can't believe the response from fans.
I mean, this album is really all us from start to finish, and we're really proud of it.
And at the Blenders release party, I was able to get a copy of their CD from the mouth. But the thing is, if you're looking in stores, it's going to take about 2 months for the stores to stock it.
Sounds great. Can I borrow your CD sometime?
Oh, sure. You can have it right now.
Okay, thanks. Okay.
There's still much more ahead on Studio One today. The University of North Dakota is hosting the Speedo Junior National Championship West Swimming Tournament. We'll talk with one athlete whose goal it is to make it to the Olympics.
Plus, a look at the Harlem Globetrotters. They've amazed people with their tricks and talents for many years. An up-close look with one of the newest players. That story plus much more straight ahead in our next half hour on Studio One.
Exposed to so many different ideas and projects. The engineering school here itself is set up so that it's the class size is reasonable and the professors are great.
Our equipment we use is up to date and very new and very accurate.
Part of the reason why I've gone into this program is because of the environmental aspects.
With about 12,000 students, UND is the largest university in the Dakotas, Montana, and western Minnesota. About 170 major fields provide education in careers that include engineering, law, medicine, aerospace, and business. Dedicated faculty, individual attention. Join us at the University of North Dakota.
Time as a Junior Achievement Elementary School volunteer can be a little scary. Can you get kids that young to think about their futures? Call us about volunteering and you'll see. We'll supply you with training for this new program and the kids will supply plenty of motivation.
Welcome back to the second half hour in Studio One.
And I'm sorry to say we have bad news as far as the weather goes.
Well, I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but after some of the nicer temperatures we've had a few weeks ago, and we're going to stay cool. In fact, temperatures back down in the 20s, snow again. Mm. It just isn't real nice.
Never ending.
That's the Midwest for us.
It sure is.
Okay, thanks, Craig. Well, just ahead on this final half hour, Studio One, Minn Kota Power will demonstrate the exciting cookie possibilities with the Flashbake Oven. It cooks faster than a microwave oven without creating a rubbery taste to the food.
Also in this half hour, we'll talk with Coach Bill Rose and swimmer Mark Kwok. They're taking part in the Speedo Junior National Championship West Swimming Meet. They hope to make it to the Olympics.
But before we talk with our guests, let's get to our news update from Jennifer Vandergon. Jennifer?
Thanks, Scott. The last U.S. troops have left Somalia, ending the military's 15-month involvement, Operation Restore Hope. 120 soldiers and 1,100 Marines departed from Mogadishu's airport. Only 50 Marines remain in Mogadishu to guard the U.S. Embassy. President Clinton ordered the withdrawal after 18 soldiers were killed in a battle in Mogadishu last October. In Mexico, authorities say a 23-year-old factory worker has confessed to a murder likened to the Robert Kennedy assassination. Leading presidential candidate Luis Donaldo Colosio was gunned down during a campaign rally in Tijuana Wednesday. There's no word on a motive. Thousands paid their respect to Colosio in Mexico City Thursday. The mourners included President Carlos Salinas, who supported Colosio as his successor. Colosio's former rivals joined Salinas in urging their countrymen to remain calm. As times are changing, people are finding it necessary to be more politically correct. This awareness is also being adopted by the deaf community. American Sign Language has been changing to avoid using signs that make a graphic reference to stereotypical physical features. Some examples of changing signs are words such as African American, Japanese, and homosexual.
That's where I think a lot of this is coming from now, is the people themselves are saying, this is the sign that we would like to use to represent us as a culture or as a population or as a group.
Interpreters also say because signs are developed by people who use the words the most, it often takes a long time for new signs to be used. A recent study by Ohio State University found that parents are often more insulting as their teens get older. Psychologists say that this behavior may be linked to how parents relate to their children. The study consisted of 85 teens ages 11 to 15 and their parents. The teens had 2 8-minute talks with each parent, one on a pleasant topic and one on a provoking subject. The results showed the parents used more negative comments as the age of the children increased. When people think of spring break, they usually picture a hot, sunny beach in the south. But for some students, heading south means more than lying in the sun. Studio One reporter Lucy Sivka found some UND students who would rather lend a helping hand than get a good tan.
Few college students spend their spring break hammering nails or learning to saw 2x4s. 25 students and volunteers from UND drove down to Starkville, Mississippi to build houses for an organization known as Habitat for Humanity. Habitat is a Christian housing ministry which builds houses for low-income families around the world.
When students and volunteer carpenters arrived at the work site early Monday morning, what we saw was the early beginnings of a house. Now, 5 days later, we see how working together can make such organizations as Habitat for Humanity such a success.
The organization has been building houses since 1976 and will be building house number 30,000 in July. Students and volunteers working on the site say the week is a way to get in touch with the Southern culture and help others at the same time.
It's a worthwhile project to give some of your time. We have a lot of time on our hands in some ways. Some people don't have a lot of treasure to give, but it's a way to give some of your time and to learn a few talents in the process.
There are three separate work sites which the students spend their week pounding away on. Work begins early in the morning and continues until late afternoon, which is either when people have had too much sun or too much wind. The children from the surrounding neighborhoods are always happy to have the workers around. They're quick to lend a hand and help. Some of the kids take a little more pride in their work than others. That's because it's their future home they're working on. All the work is volunteer, and a professional carpenter heads up the construction teams at each site. The Habitat for Humanity group shows how teamwork can accomplish something as great as giving someone a new home. I'm Lucy Sivka for Studio One News.
People can get involved with the local chapter of Habitat for Humanity and build houses right here in Grand Forks. The nice weather we've had has the Red River on the thaw. Thin ice makes water emergencies a major concern. The Grand Forks Water Rescue Team has been around to answer calls for help for 3 years. The rescue team's equipment is all donated and includes an inflatable boat and an ambulance. Officials say it's impossible to monitor the river shoreline for daredevils. They stress the dangers of icy waters and currents.
We as humans aren't made to be in the water, per se. Yes, we can go out there and swim and have all this fun, but when something goes wrong, we can't breathe in the water, and then we're, you know, risking expiring.
Special dry suits are worn by divers to reach victims. However, at 30 below, air valves stick open. The water rescue team is dispatched through 911 fire and rescue, and they hope eventually donations will provide them with equipment to work in any environment. And as I said, they are looking for donations all the time. Those can be given through the Grand Forks Sheriff's Department.
Mm-hmm. Important for times of emergencies. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Jennifer. Well, if basketball were as easy as these people make it look, we'd all be superstars. The Harlem Globetrotters thrive on giving everyone a show that is worth more than their money. Today, the team continues with tradition while adding a few new ingredients. Just take an all-male basketball team, add one female, and you've got a real crowd pleaser. Kim Fisher reports.
Any way you look at it, Gillette Law always seems to get a bit more attention than her teammates. Otherwise known by her fans as Jazzy, Gillette says being in the spotlight is something she's gotten used to.
I really expected to target the women and the little girls, but it, you know, now I'm getting the reception from everybody. Everybody's really appreciating me, and they're really, you know, surprised by my play. So that makes me feel good. It gives me a heartwarming feeling. It makes me appreciate my job that much more.
Gillette also appreciates the special privileges she receives as the only female on the team.
It's a great experience. It's just being like a queen amongst a lot of kings. You know, I'm that key ingredient with the Globetrotters. You know, everybody wants to know where's the female, where's the female. I get a lot of attention, and the privileges, I get my own room. If it ever came down to it that that the hotels don't have any rooms and they have to get together, I'll end up getting my own room. So I get my own locker room. There's a lot of different things that come along with it. I get a lot of special privileges that, you know, those guys don't get.
She may get her own locker room, but minutes before the show, the queen and a few of her kings gather to work on strategy.
I'm really getting killed right now, but that's okay. I'm coming out of this.
And although they may be opponents during this game, out on the court, they work together.
It's real nice having the female trot on the team, and Jolette, she's special because she happens to be the only female on the team. Plus, she has a warm personality that blends with everybody else, so we all get along very well.
Well enough to know when Jolette needs a little time to prepare herself before
right now,
showtime.
Get focused on the game, the show. You know, our routine. Hoping that we have a great crowd and they're warm enough to cheer and enjoy. I'm sure they're gonna enjoy. No doubt that they're gonna enjoy. That's just like. Thank you very much. And. It's my timekeeper there.
And when it comes to performance time, Gillette puts on her game face and becomes jazzy in more ways than one.
It's just like, you know, mostly like any other job when you go to work. Some people need coffee to perk up. I just need to laugh and trip with the guys a little bit, beat them, get my morale up. Self-esteem, when you beat men, self-esteem up.
And even though Jazzy gets most of the attention because she's female, her teammates get it in other ways. And of course, the Globetrotters just have to ham it up with our TV cameras.
Hi there, Studio One. Hi there, Studio One. We love you, Studio One.
We love you, Studio One.
Yeah, I think we get this, Studio One.
Female or not, being a Globetrotter is something everyone dreams of becoming.
It takes a very unique person to be a Globetrotter, but I challenge anyone. You know, if you have the skills, you think you can be a Globetrotter, go for it.
Okay, now let's see if it's as easy as it looks. Kim Fisher, Studio One.
That looked fun to do.
I had to try a couple times.
Yeah, so how did Gillette get into this?
Well, she was actually trying out for something completely different. A scout from the Globetrotter saw her, invited her to camp, and she's been a Globetrotter ever since.
Is it sort of tough for her as far as the only female? Was she the first one to be on the Globetrotter?
She's actually the seventh female, but they like to just have one at a time because it draws just the right amount of attention.
That would make sense. Thanks, Kim. Well, up next on Studio One, a young swimmer with hopes of heading to the Olympics. That's next.
Community Bank means to me excellent service and good friends. I would really recommend Community Bank. I have sent several friends over to see Larry Morgan too. I think he's great. They can answer any question over there and they'll tell you right. I have had such excellent service there that I believe that you would be treated royally if you came in there too.
Real quality, real value.
real commitment, and real satisfaction. At Nissan of Grand Forks, quality is our commitment.
Not only does Grand Forks bring in the cold weather, but this week it is also attracting more than 1,400 junior national swimmers. The Speedo Junior National Championship West is underway at UND's Hislop Sports Center. These swimmers are from the western half of the United States, including Alaska and Hawaii, some with Olympic aspirations. With us today is Coach Bill Rose from the Mission Viejo, California Nadadores, and one of his top swimmers, Mark Kwok. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you.
Coach Rose, we'll start with you. What does it take for a swimmer to even make it to the junior nationals?
Well, quite a bit, actually. This is the national championship, if you will, for 18 and under, and there are approximately 700,000 swimmers 18 and under in the United States, and so when you think that there are 900 here, it's quite a percentage of or a small percentage that make it this far.
Do they have to qualify in order to get to the
There are qualifying standards that they have to achieve in order for each event in order to come.
Now, what step is the Junior Nationals in getting to the Olympics?
It's the intermediary step from the Junior Nationals to the National Championships and then to the Olympic Trials, and only the top two swimmers in the entire country in any event go to the Olympics, so that is the pinnacle.
Now, Mark, you've competed in how many events this week?
I've competed in three so far, and I have one left today.
One left today?
Right.
And how many eventually? It goes until Saturday?
You're only allowed to swim four.
Oh,
so,
really?
I just have 500 free left and a couple of relays.
Okay, and how have you done so far?
I've done pretty well. I've had all best times. I placed 8th in the 1,000 and 10th in the 200 butterfly, and just went my best time in the 100 freestyle.
So does this mean that you will then go on to the Olympic trials?
Not quite yet. Still a couple more, like Coach Rose, stepping stones to take in order to get there, and I hope to get there soon.
How much time in preparation goes into preparing for these meets, Mark?
There's a lot of practices, early in the morning and then back in the afternoon at night. A lot of hard work and just, you know, a positive attitude and hope to do well.
Now, I've noticed some of the swimmers shave their bodies. Mark doesn't hear, but does that really give them an extra edge when they are swimming?
At the national championships, yes, and Mark does. He just doesn't shave his head this particular meet, but all of the swimmers will, at the national championship, shave legs, arms, back, any kind of body hair that they might have, and it's a combination of an actual feeling, a sensitive feeling, if you will, to the water, and there are some physiological reasons for it as well, but it's really a feeling more than anything else.
Other than that, how do you as a coach prepare these kids for these meets?
Well, as Mark said, we train anywhere from 15 to 20,000 meters a day, which is about 17 miles a day, so
wow.
If you would get out and run that far,
mm-hmm.
that's how far we're swimming. So they train very, very hard.
Now, Mark, you have an interesting situation. You have dual citizenship in the U.S. and in Hong Kong. If you were to go to the Olympics, who would you represent?
It'd probably depend, you know. I'd probably wait maybe another year or so and see what my standings are here and how things are over there, and then make a decision, you know, which place will be better for me and, you know, which situation will suit me best.
Coach Rose, how has your team as a whole done this week, as well as you expected?
Actually better than I expected. We're very young.
Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of, Mark's only 16, we have a lot of 15-year-olds here and so on, and so the fact that they're swimming their best times, and we're real, very pleased. And we did not expect to be in the team title race, and we're second right now, and there's a possibility we could win it.
Well, congratulations on your victories this far, and good luck.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us. Up next on Studio One, we'll demonstrate the wonders of the Flashbake oven. Very soon, it could replace the microwave.
Thank you. Hey, were you guys born in a house?
Yeah. What have we got to graze on?
Nothing.
Please?
Now, don't be making those big cow eyes at okay.
It is okay if you give them the good stuff. Mootown Snackers, cheese and sticks, or cheese and pretzels. The deliciously dippable snacks.
Animals.
From Mootown Snackers.
Influence are you under?
Newman Outdoor Advertising, a sight for more eyes. Outdoor advertising, it's bigger than life. It gives you flexibility. Use it as a constant reminder. Use it to advertise your message or product. Outdoor advertising, it's big, it's bold. Get your message across. Outdoor advertising, it works. For more information, call Bill Kasager in Fargo or Grand Forks.
Welcome back to Studio One. You're looking at the latest technology in cooking. It's faster than a microwave, but cooks with light and ultraviolet rays. It's called the Flashbake Oven. Jerry Fiskum from Minn Kota Power shows us a new way to cook food in record time with using less energy with the Flashbake Oven. Jerry, thanks for joining us today.
You're welcome.
And in just a couple seconds, what's going to be coming out?
We will have a chicken breast coming out of here, and I think it's going to be one of the tastiest chicken breasts that you have ever had.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about what the Flashbake Oven is?
All right, well, the Flashbake Oven is a new, our chicken is coming out now. It's a new technology in cooking, and it cooks with light. It cooks with visible light, high-intensity visible light. There's two banks of lights in the oven, one on top, one on the bottom. And both of those banks can be controlled for the intensity of the light. And then you control the time also. And by controlling the intensity of the light and the time, you control the food, how well you want it done. Okay. I'm going to put the steak in right now.
Why is Minn Kota particularly interested in this type of technology?
There's a couple reasons why Minn Kota is interested in this. Number one, because of the energy savings that it provides. It's a very energy efficient product. Number two, this is a new electric technology, and electric technologies are very kind to the environment because you have no source of pollution at the point of, or no emissions at the point of use. Also, it helps reduce energy costs for consumers. So those are three benefits of this technology.
Okay. So does Kim get to try the first part of it?
Kim gets to try a piece of this chicken here.
Now it's hot when it comes out, so it has to take a little while to cool.
Now how long did this chicken actually take?
This chicken cooked for about 120 seconds.
Make sure it's not hot. It's still hot. But it's good.
Okay.
The only thing we have done to this chicken is put just a little bit of seasoning on it.
Okay. Well, we'll also have a graphic of just how quick some things cook in the oven. The chicken took 2 minutes. A 9-inch pizza took about 50 seconds. You know, if you have fish, about 120 seconds. But the big thing, and we have now about 140 seconds for a steak that should be coming out pretty soon. But it's just so quick. How is it different than the microwave oven? What makes it quicker?
Because of the intense visible light, it penetrates the food and cooks from the intense visible light cooks from the inside out, while the infrared, which is also in here, cooks from the outside in. The infrared is what browns the food, and the visible light is what cooks it from the inside out. So you get a faster cooking cycle.
Now, can you just put one piece of chicken or one piece of steak at a time?
You can put several pieces of chicken in here. I just did it one for the demonstration. You can put several pieces of chicken, several pieces of steak. It works very well for shrimp. It works well for hash browns. There are some limitations to the oven. Obviously, you can see we have a small cooking cavity, and you can't cook a turkey or a roast or something like that in here. But so long as it's an inch to an inch and a half, this oven is a marvelous way to cook.
How about baking? Can you bake in there?
You can't bake bread in here. The company is currently testing raw dough to see what they can do with it, but they haven't perfected that yet.
Okay.
Okay, let's see how the steak looks here.
This steak, I have it programmed for to be about medium, and we'll let it sit here for just a second, and you can tell the dish is hot.
Okay. Now, how much electricity does this use compared to the standard oven in the home?
The standard oven is approximately 12,000 watts. This, when it's cooking at full capacity, when you've got the lights at full intensity, uses about 10,000 watts. But because you're not necessarily cooking at full intensity all the time, that varies.
Mm-hmm.
The thing about this is that it cooks so much faster than your conventional oven that it's much more efficient.
Mm-hmm.
Let's get this steak out of here and let's take it.
Now, are we going to see this more in the house or, say, a restaurant? Where
right,
is it going to be
right
more
now,
permanent?
Right now, this is more for commercial establishments, but in about 3 to 5 years, you will see these ready for the home.
Can you only use a certain type of glassware in there, or any type will work?
This is a special type of glassware that has been developed for Quadlux, the maker of the oven.
Mm-hmm.
It's made by Visionware, and it's made in such a way that when you take it out of the hot oven and put it on a cold surface, it won't crack. You can't do that with any other type of glassware. So this is a special glassware which has been made for the oven.
How does it taste?
It's good. You can put any type of spices on.
You can put any type of spices on. Basically, you can cook a steak the way you would on a grill or a range. Except it's faster in here.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Much
Jerry,
faster.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, Jerry.
Appreciate it. And this should be on the market in about 3 to 5 years.
Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Jerry, from Minn Kota Power. You're watching Studio One, and we'll be back right after this. It was really...
The right combination of protection, value, response, and service. That's our philosophy, and it has been since 1947. Voller Insurance, Grand Forks, Devil's Lake, Bismarck.
Here's one time it doesn't matter who your neighbor is. Here's the other. Life's too short. Stop the hate.
In a life-threatening emergency, you should know what to do. Say a loved one exhibits unusual symptoms. The first thing to do is...
Clear!
No. The first thing to
do... Oh! Tourniquet!
No! The first thing you do is pick up the phone and dial your emergency number.
Call 911 first.
Right.
How about mouth-to-mouth?
I don't think so. Hmm. To learn more about life-saving techniques, contact your Red Cross.
The insurance salesperson. They've never been the most popular people in town. Until you need them. Voller Insurance. Grand Forks, Devil's Lake, Bismarck.
Now, the food tasted really good. It was
it
quick and it was fast.
It tasted really good, and for people with today's lifestyles, it's going to be a great, great new thing.
Okay, good. Well, that's it for today's edition of Studio One. Minn Kota Power was going to be here with the Flashbake Oven and cook the whole Studio One crew some eggs and breakfast, so
good.
We're excited about that. We're going to leave you today with more music from the Blenders and their song, The Girl Is Good. I'm Scott Seiler, and for everyone here at Studio One, thanks so much for joining us. See you in 2 weeks.
The time is right.
sure love tonight, like you know I would want that.